Once again to our friends on Facebook and YouTube, we are so glad that you have joined us for another night of Pulse Worship Online. Look, I know it's not the same as being in the building. I am missing worship. I'm missing being in the room with my friends and family of choice, but I want to let you know this is really blessing me. I'm having a hard time being quarantined. I'm having a hard time not having that connection with those whom I love. But this is the one way we get to come together every week still and worship with one another, find strength, connect, chat, all just still gather in the same place. And if it's blessing me, I know it's got to be blessing you. And I continue to stay faithful to it, just like you would go to church if on a regular week, if not more. It's so much easier to just swipe up on a screen and be right there virtually in this church service. So I challenge you to continue to find ways to be connected, whether it's on our eFam or whether it's a Zoom small group or just giving online. There are so many things that still have to happen and have to go on. And even though we find ourselves in turmoil, we find ourselves financially struggling in uncertain times, disrupted like this series says, we are still the church and we still have a job to do and lives to reach and a difference to make in this world. So I challenge you to give, whether it be through texting, whether it be giving online. You can even write a check and mail in your offering like it's old school. I mean, like, all those options are still available. So thank you for worshiping with us. Continue to worship with us tonight. Push that share button. Let somebody know what they're missing out on tonight. And let's give as you feel compelled.
That little worship session we had in this room, we just begin to sing, "Here I am."
Completely, Lord.
And then we sing this verse. hand clap of praise as you're seated.
Welcome back to post-Easter Pulse Worship. I hope that you're enjoying these worship times as much as I am. They are certainly a midweek pick-me-up. Please join me in a word of prayer. God of the universe, we call out to you and cry out to you, knowing that you will hear us and see us, knowing that you love us and that you call us beloved. May we fully lean into all that you have for us, all the lessons we need to learn, all the ways in which we need to understand ourselves, this world, and you more fully, so that we can be people of the resurrection, people who live a life that is really, truly the life that you have for us. May it be so in the name of Jesus. So as you know, we are beginning a new sermon series this week. We will have it for a few weeks, and it is called Disrupted. Now, I have a few confessions to make as we begin. Number one, the sermon series was originally entitled Do Not Disturb, and it was going to be imaginative and inventive and insightful, a look into our busy culture, how sometimes we need to put do not disturb signs on our phones, the D&D, or put do not disturb signs outside of our proverbial doors and shut the world out so that we can spend time growing in ourselves, growing with our loved ones, and growing in God. And so we make those beautiful plans months and months and months ago, and then God laughs, or at least the universe laughed, right? We are actually in a time of the great pause, and so we know this is nothing that any of us have chosen, but we decided instead to use the same scriptures and sermon series, but instead title it Disrupted, right? Because it, I think, explains better on what we're going through and what's going on right now. Because even though we maybe didn't choose to be disrupted, choose to have a pause, choose to put on a do not disturb sign on the world, we didn't choose that, but we can live fully into it in the same way that those principles are life-giving and challenging to us, right? We didn't choose this time of disruption, but we can choose what we do with it, right? I have a second confession to make. This is the fourth time I've recorded this. I try not to do it too many times because I want it to seem like a conversation, like a live thing that we would do when I preach on Pulse Worship. But I have cats. I live in a loft. They come up, make noises. You may still hear them. I may just preach through it this time. The second time I did this, right in the middle of it, someone knocked loudly on my door and wouldn't go away. And it turned out to be wonderful friends dropping off an Easter basket on my front porch and my front door. So we didn't get close to 6 feet apart, but that was a beautiful interruption. So it reminded me, even in the middle of this sermon kicking off the series disruption, that interruptions can be beautiful, wonderful, and life-giving. And the third confession I have to make is that, you know, we record these ahead of time, but this is recorded on Holy Saturday. I've always thought this is sort of a weird or interesting kind of day in the middle of Holy Week, right? We begin with Palm Sunday. Traditionally, we have a Monday-Thursday service, which of course, Monday comes from the word mandate, which means command, a new commandment is given. We celebrate it on Thursday with a retelling of the Last Supper in a creative way. Oftentimes communion and foot washing goes with that service because that's how Jesus embodied the end of his ministry in those ways, profoundly telling his followers, and by extension us today, to love. Love is the greatest commandment. And then Good Friday, which of course good comes from a more old English understanding of the word good, which means holy or reverent or revered. And so Good Friday is the Holy Friday where we lean into the pain of the cross, the reality and the image of Christ on the cross, and the starkness of the empty time in between that time and resurrection. And so I actually hope that you went back and watched our Good Friday worship service. It was powerful and profound. It is usually my favorite service of the year, and I didn't know how I would feel about it. And this year it was as powerful, even in my own home watching it. The starkness of the imagery at the end was particularly profound for me. And so I think to start a sermon series called Disruption or Disrupted, it's perfect to do it on Holy Saturday, on this day in between the two realities, right? Because we're living sort of an extended Holy Saturday of our own during what people are calling the great pause, right? The great pause of life. We are living in the time in between the time, right? The time where we know what happened before, we don't know what's gonna happen next, and we're living in the middle of all of that, right? Just like the disciples did on Holy Saturday, right? Good Friday is what was, the reality may be gone, maybe hope is waning, right? The Christ is crucified, and we're in between that and Holy Saturday, and then we get the resurrection and the cross, right? So what was is no longer, and what is more profoundly beautiful than you ever could have imagined before. And I love that this pulse worship is post-Easter, right? So we've experienced Easter, we've celebrated it together, and praise Jesus. Easter is my favorite and most meaningful holiday that we celebrate on the church calendar, because there is something profoundly powerful about God breaking into the universe, right? Collectively reminding us that love reigns and rules, and that death can never overcome it. And if you recall, I'm here on Holy Saturday, or the in-between Saturday. It was a weird weather day. Now, not weird for people who are native Texans or Southern people, but I'm from California. And so it had what always deems to me as such an interesting day. It began, as you remember, for those of you, it's Wednesday. Maybe Saturday was like 3 months ago or a minute ago, depending on how you work your weeks now. Holy Saturday had a really unique weather with it, right? Like, not unique to Texas, but for me. In the morning, it was beautiful and sunny, and I got up and I took a walk and I wore my mask. If you've seen it, it's a cat mask. I did a walk. My cats were outside on the patio lounging in the sun and loved it. And then a little before noon, maybe like 11:30-ish, all of a sudden, thunder out of nowhere, booming, bamming out of nowhere, rain coming down, right? And it was profound. It was interesting. And I think that even for me was a picture of maybe the experience we're all having during this disrupted time, during this time of the great pause, right? Our disrupted moment, right? We will experience in this time moments of sunlight and beauty and love and newness. And we will also experience moments of thunder and rain and gloom and doom, right? And sometimes those moments will be right next to each other, one after the other, and that's okay. These moments are gonna be what they are, and we need to live into them and understand them, right? So let's all agree first on what disruption is, or what it means to be disrupted. The actual term is, it's an event or an activity or a process that is interrupted, right? And that's certainly the time that we're in now. Our events, our activities, our processes are interrupted. And that is a disruption, right? We're all staying at home, flattening the curve. My hope is you are getting masks, being safe. For those of you who are essential workers, helping us live more beautiful and good lives. Those of you who are on the front lines, not only first responders, law enforcement, also doctors, and all of those who work in the medical fields, thank you for all that you're doing, right? But together we are trying to flatten the curve and make us all healthy. And so we are leaning into this moment, right? It is different for all of us, this experience, right? I shared a meme on social media, which is how we're pastoring these days, apparently, reminding us all that this isn't a collective holiday, right? This isn't fun. No one is choosing this. We are working at home based on the need to do so, not the want to do so. And that's a very different way to think about this time. We didn't choose it. We're all experiencing trauma, and we're experiencing it on different levels and at different ways, right? Some of us get to still work during this time, and we are blessed, and we are figuring out new normals. And if you're like me, you're a little exhausted because how to function in this time where there it seems like there's no time off and there's always time on, and I'm having to figure out new technology, which also isn't my strong suit. All of this is overwhelming, right? Some of us have lost jobs, right? And we are struggling to figure out what our next paycheck will look like, how we get help from our government during this time. We're figuring things out. Some of us have become homeschoolers, and I can identify with that not being a life choice that you made, right? You are homeschooling while you're trying to work. Some of us are sick, and some of us have recovered. Some of us are sick, and some of us are dying, or we know people that are sick or dying, right? We're seeing images come out of places like New York and other parts of the world that are very upsetting and very just dismal, you know, the bodies and things that are happening around the world. Some of us are trying to celebrate birthdays, but also attempting to memorialize loss during this time. I know people that have experienced loss that necessarily doesn't have to do with the virus. It's just loss that they were having anyway. And now memorial services and ways to grieve are just non-existent in traditional ways. Some of us have lost big vacations, family events, right? Graduations, traditions of all kinds are gonna be lost. And so this is just a reminder that this is collective trauma, this is collective difficulty. We have been disrupted, we didn't choose this time. I was talking to my middle niece, her name is Ellie, and I call her Tiny E because we were born on the same day, years apart, but the same day. And she was sharing with me, you know, she is in elementary school and this is her last year in elementary school. And next year she goes to middle school. I cannot believe it, number one. Number two, there's all these end of the year events she was looking forward to, not only graduation, but there was trips and fun events. And she's missing out on all of those things as she ends her year, right? She's at home with her family. She doesn't get to see all of her friends. She loves school. She loves her teacher. She was excited to end her time in elementary school. She will miss her school. She loved it there. And she doesn't get any of that. And we were chatting and I said, it is okay for you to feel sad about that. In fact, I encourage you to, you need to feel sad about that. You will, on the other side of it, have new experiences to appreciate, but it's okay to be sad. And so at this time, we don't pretend that this disruption or being disrupted isn't heartbreaking in so many ways. We don't pretend that that isn't true, like that it's not difficult. And God always is the God of the great ands, right? And at the same time, when we come together in worship, we acknowledge that often, in fact, more often than not, not always, when God wants to do something significant or big, it is usually disguised or wrapped up in interruption or disruption, right? When God wants to do something big or good or cataclysmic, it rarely begins with a human agenda. I don't know about you, but never in my life have I put out my human calendar and said, this is what's happening Monday, Tuesday, God's gonna rock my world, Wednesday, I'm gonna go to work. You know, I've never had that happen. So if you have, call me, email me, let me know what you did. But usually I plan a week and in the middle of it somewhere, God's going, you think that's gonna happen? It's not gonna happen. I'm gonna blow your mind. And so we remember, right, that God does big things. In fact, the Hebrew scriptures are stories of people either being interrupted or people leaning into disrupting culture or the narratives of the world, right? In fact, I would say that disrupted is something that you could describe all of scripture. All of the stories of God and God's people are living lives that are disrupted by God in powerful and profound ways, right? The Gospels are classic stories of disruption. Jesus's ministry could actually be called one of being disrupted, interrupted all the time. He certainly had an agenda, and notice that agenda always included being interrupted and disrupted. He always stopped. That woman touched me. That person needs healing. That person is blind. That person needs help. Always put those people, those spiritual circumstances over any sort of intention he had. And I think that's a powerful lesson for us, right? We are disrupted, right? And of course we've celebrated Easter because we are in post-resurrection mode, woo woo, right? Praise Jesus. And is there a more perfect understanding of being disrupted than resurrection, right? It is the cross. It is the ultimate disruption of the status quo and of death itself, right? The ultimate expression of being disrupted, being interrupted. The resurrection reminds us that God does powerful things no matter what the circumstances. Even death itself is no match for God. And if death is no match for God, we have nothing to fear or worry about, right? Now, I want to remind you, a side note is not every interruption is God, right? Some of us struggle with focus. Squirrel, that every time I do that, it's God being a squirrel, taking my focus. But oftentimes, in these moments of disruption, God is doing something profound and needs to get our attention, right? And so this time we're going to lean into it. And Reverend Neil and Reverend Andrew and Reverend Michael and myself are going to walk you through finding purpose and hope and new life and living into the pain and reality and the good and the bad and everything that goes with this time in the middle of this huge cultural upheaval. and the interruptions of daily life, right? We're going to challenge you to grow as you're able in the midst of this huge life glitch, right? Grow in the midst of the glitch. You can write all those down. And today I wanted us to focus, or tonight rather, on Ephesians 2, which is the book written to the community in Ephesus. Of course, the epistles, the letters in the New Testament, are beautiful pictures for us and reminders for us of people not only during struggle, right, but during a post-resurrection life, learning and figuring out how to embody the understanding and reality of Christ and the Spirit within them in their daily, everyday lives, in this changing world that they were living in. And so I love a lot of the texts. And this one in particular is still at the beginning of Ephesians. It's still the author's intention to let this group of beautiful people know who are coming together in corporate worship and house worship. And they are being reminded of who they are, and so are you. And these are the words: "For we are God's handiwork," or I would say craftsmanship, or God's hobby, right? Or the thing that God does so beautifully. "We are created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. So for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." And so my reminder and challenge and hope is that you will lean in to the idea that God might want to do something powerful and profound with you during this time of being disrupted. That God sees you and knows you and wants you to come out of the other side of this more healthy and whole, right? With a different perspective, with some new choices, right? And so we're reminded that we are God's handiwork. We are God's craftsmanship. I like to say we are God's hobby and crafts. Like, people, I'm so jealous of people who have hobbies, right? I jokingly said my hobbies are like eating out, hanging out with friends, and going out, right? I'm not doing many of my hobbies, but I am God's hobby. Like, God delights when I learn and do new things, when I am reformed and remade, and God doesn't make mistakes, and God is doing all of that for my good, right? That I am and you are created in Christ Jesus in this post-resurrection world to do good works. We're created for a purpose, to do good works. And what are those good works, right? They are prepared in advance by God for us to do. And all that means is, again, we may have an agenda, but God's agenda is higher than our agenda. God's agenda is bigger than our agenda. God's agenda usurps our agenda, right? There are things right now that God has prepared for you in the future to do, maybe in the recent soon future, maybe in the far off future, that God has for you to do that you can't even conceptualize. You have no idea the profound ways that God will work in your life and through your life to heal you and to heal other people. And I want you to hear that tonight and live into that during this time of the great pause, right? And I want to let you know there's another meaning for disruption. I learned about it. It's a meaning that is new. It was coined in the 90s, and it's the term disruptive innovation. I don't know if you ever heard of it, but it means a process whereby a company or a group of people with fewer resources is able to, through innovation and creativity, successfully challenge established business networks or markets, right? And you can see all around a world in which we're living in, especially in the 20th into the 21st century, where so much innovation caused disruption in markets, disruption in the ways in which we always did things, right? I can't even imagine living without a microwave. I know some people don't use them, but I don't even know what I would do without a microwave. And that disrupted the Holly Homemaker life, right? The Brad Homemaker life, like, right? It disrupted all of that. And there's these inventions that move into our lives. You know, we don't ride horse-drawn carriages anymore because automobiles came along, and thank goodness for that, right? I'm hoping hovercrafts are next. Fingers crossed. And so we can lean into this time thinking that maybe God is doing something new and wanting us to do new things, to innovate, to reinvent, to be innovative, right? To do good things, right? God, again, might want to do something in you and through you during this time of disruption. Because we know that God didn't cause the pause, right? But God can use the pause for our personal growth, for our church growth, for our community growth and for this world to be a better place, right? The betterment of everyone, innovation, creativity explode, I imagine, post this time and during this time, right? There are things that we can do and will do that we can't even fathom now because we've gotten this break, right? And again, this break wasn't chosen and it's not easy. And we are not choosing it, but here we are, right? Here we are. And so the beautiful thing is that we get to decide, right? As our world is being shaken up, as our lives are being upheaved, right? And changed and challenged, we are in the midst of this great, like a great pause, like I've said, right? We have some decisions to make. And I hope that we'll make them together, right? They're not decisions I can make for you, but there are things that you have learned and realized if you take a moment that you gave your time and talent and your money to before this happened that now you don't miss and you think, I don't need to do that again. There are habits that you're now newly forming, you know, that you are thinking, wow, maybe I should walk every day outside. Maybe I should eat differently. Maybe I should eat more at home or whatever those things are. But there are also things where you miss some of the things you did and you're looking back and you're saying, man, I miss the things that I chose to do. Those were good things and I'm keeping those things, right? But even now you're realizing the things that are worth saving and the things that are worth deciding to maybe say, this doesn't need to go into the post, you know, the post upheaval world, the post disrupted world. And when we get back to normals, we get to create a new normal. And there's gonna be a whole world out there that will tell us what the new normal should be. And that will often look like what the old normal was. And my challenge to you is to give yourself permission to lean into this time. Maybe rediscover ways you're grateful for all the things you had before, and all those things should go with you, but maybe there's a new order to them or a new way to look at them or a new place for them, right? This is your time where everything is interrupted, everything is disrupted, time for you to look and change and challenge yourself. Right? Not in huge, profound ways, but in meaningful ways, small ways every day, relying on God, praying, reminding yourself to reach out to the people that you love, connect with them, make sure they're okay, right? There are beautiful decisions to be made that you will take into this new normal. And so I encourage you and challenge you to lean into this disrupted life. We didn't choose it, but here we are. And we, the beautiful thing is, we get to decide, you and me, who we will be at the end of it. You get to decide, only you can decide what you take with you and what you leave behind in this brave new world. And so my promise to you is that we will be with you every step of the way, giving you encouragement and worship, reminding you the God of the universe sees you and knows you and loves you, and so do we. I love you. And in the middle of it, my prayer is that you will take a good look at everything in your life. Be grateful for the things you've always had. Look ahead to the person, to the community, to the couple, to the person, to the student, to the worker, the person that you want to be at the other end of this. And the beauty is you are learning along with the rest of us. So as you are disrupted, know that you are disrupted, but you are not down. You are disrupted, but there is hope. You are disrupted, and there is a God with you who crafted you beautifully, who did a workmanship in you through Christ Jesus so that you could do good works, and has far more amazing and profound and beautiful things for you to do than you could ever imagine. My beautiful community, lean into this disruptive time. God will work in this disruption. You are disrupted, but not down. God is with you. Be encouraged. Be inspired. Be the person that you've always known you are. Continue to lean into that beautiful life. Beloved family, may it be so. Amen.
The presence of God is here. Come on, we need God's presence to reign in this place.
Every Lazarus, and your voice is calling.